take this time. My name is Richard Mariani. I'm the athletic director here at Topeka West High School. John Ostrich and Joe Strog told me that this would be the best part of this job, and they are exactly right. Welcome back to all of you inductees. I want to thank our administration, Mr. Dustin Dick, our principal, associate principal, Mr. Colin Cathy. Without them, this job is very, very difficult. They make it my job very easy. Please enjoy the evening, and again, welcome back.
I'm not as agile going up those steps as I used to be. I hope I can make it through the night. Good evening to you all. Welcome to the 18th annual Topeka West Sports Hall of Fame induction. My name is Joe Schrog, and it is my distinct honor and pleasure to be your moderator for tonight's activities. There's no place I would rather be than Topeka West on Hall of Fame night. As usual, we have marvelous inductees to hear from and about, and I can't wait to get started. Our first inductee is Brian Haney, the first voice of the Chargers. He is now the voice of the Red Raiders after having spent some time as a Rock Chalk sports talker. He will be introduced by Corey Wilson.
I'm Corey Wilson, and I am humbled, really, to get to present Brian Haney for induction into the Topeka West Athletic Hall of Fame. First, I want to thank the committee for voting Brian to this award. I've known Brian for a long time. I know that he's going to come up here in a while and tell you how he doesn't deserve to be with all these great athletes, both those being inducted tonight and those who have been inducted in the past. But that's exactly why he does deserve it. His body of work more than places him here alone. But it's his humility, the way he works with people of all ages, that creates the spark and lights the match. The program tells you that he pioneered sports broadcast for Topeka West Television, and that's true, but he did so very, very much more than that. We were the first to broadcast high school football on television in this area at any level, and that was 100% Brian, his dream, his focus, his effort. It started with a microphone directly attached to a camera and grew from there. That first year, there was test after test. That second year, Brian's senior year, we turned him loose with a plan, his plan, and he took it and ran with it. Football and basketball primarily. He was always refining his craft, and his craft became our craft. His success became our success. And there's his first halftime interview when then KU basketball player and Topeka West alum CB McGrath showed up for a game. Brian asked me if he could do it. I thought, there's no way. But I said, go ahead. Next thing I know, they're getting chairs set up and Brian has the interview going, all in a space of less than a couple of minutes. But that's Brian. CB felt he could trust him. Most people do, I think. In an effort to add more friends in his broadcast, we added multiple cameras and a scoreboard, all of it pretty much on the fly. Those multi-camera experiments became the base for all of the multi-camera work we do in remote situations, and not only sports, but also other activities and events here on campus and on the road. In fact, tonight's event is being recorded using much of the same techniques that Brian pioneered. But for Brian, it's always been sports. There's no one that prepares more, that thinks more, or cares more than Brian. Veteran sportscaster Mike Mann saw it early on, and he brought Brian in to do games at the Topeka Invitational. Veteran sportscaster Tom Hedrick saw it in Brian when Brian was a freshman at KU, and he brought Brian in to do games in that area as well. Brian, though, continued that love of high school sports until he left for Texas Tech a few short years ago. Brian, of course, has fostered more than the casual friendship while working at his craft at Kansas University, which of course is his home and has been for so long. People like legendary sports announcer Max Falkenstein and announcer and fellow Topeka West alum Bob Davis and fellow announcer David Lawrence, who is here tonight. who along with Brian have done so much for young people in their leadership of Fellowship of Christian Athletes and the Rock Chalk Round Ball Classic that benefits young people in their fight against cancer. Again, if you read the program, you can see that he's pretty much done it all, and he's earned it all, too. There's no one that works harder, studies harder, plans more than Brian Haney. There's so many stories that I've been privy to about Brian. Like the time that he was the public address announcer at Allen Fieldhouse. The game was near its end when freshman Mario Chalmers got some playing time. Brian, ever the studier of players, knew that Chalmers had a high school nickname. Brian watched him enter, and when Mario scored, Brian referred to him as Super Mario, perhaps one of the first times that was ever used. There's more to that story, but I'm not going to tell you. Perhaps the best comment that I've heard about Brian came from, or at least was attributed to, KU basketball Bill Self when he said, "Brian's a stud." Enough said. Brian stayed connected to high school, I think, in part because he feels he owes it so much. I chuckle at that because I know how much he has done for high school sports. He's known around the state for his efforts and has been the recipient of countless awards from the Kansas Association of Broadcasters as well as the Kansas State High School Activities Association. He stayed close to Topeka West as well. When he was in Lawrence, we would bring him back to talk to our classes, and he would mentor some of our announcers. Brian has always been willing. He's invited our kids to events, invited them to remote broadcasts, opportunities most folks just don't get. Now that he's in Texas, he still sends advice and pep talks to kids. I ask him to give a boost to, and Brian, I've got a couple that need that right now, so we'll talk later. Look, I don't want to steal his thunder here, so I'll stop, but I do want to say this to Brian. Brian, you come from great parents, Topeka West alums themselves. As a high school announcer, you were all city, you were all league, you were all state. Never doubt for a moment that you don't deserve to be here. We are proud of your efforts with your craft, but even more, we're proud of the integrity that you carry with you in helping our young people become young men and women and giving them hope. It's a great honor to present Brian Haney to the Topeka West Athletic Hall of Fame. Brian?
Thank you so much, Mr. Wilson. That was incredible. I really appreciate those words. I'll tell you what, before I get started, this doesn't feel quite right doing this in a normal suit. My best public speaking at Topeka West High School came with one of those studly purple blazers, so excuse me one second. I'll do my best Clark Kent in a phone booth here. We don't know where those original purple blazers went. I think Adam Wright on the left in the picture took them off to KU to try and impress the ladies. But I did find this on eBay the other day, and you'll notice the sleeves fit just right, just like they did in that photo. So that feels much more like it, right? Kind of looks like one of those cheesy Pro Football Hall of Fame jackets, so it's apropos for the evening. 135, not the number of Big 12 games I've called. 135. Not the length of this speech, I'm probably far too verbose for that. 135. Probably what I weighed for most of high school, but still not what I'm getting at here either. What is 135? 135 was what I scored on my first day of representing Topeka West Athletics in a sporting event. I was a freshman junior varsity golfer in Ozaukee, Kansas at Village Greens. Let that sink in for a second. CC, especially you, 135, that's like 63 over par. Coach Mariani should have made me walk home from Ozaukee that day, but he didn't. The point is, I was far from an extraordinary golfer. Heck, I was far from an ordinary golfer. And yet, I'm incredibly fortunate to be honored here tonight with all of you, because this far from even ordinary athlete was blessed with some extraordinary relationships, influences, and incredible opportunities. And it all began right here at Topeka West High School. The man who so graciously introduced me moments ago was the catalyst for my entire career. Mr. Wilson saw my ambition and my enthusiasm for sportscasting and not only gave me an unprecedented platform to hone my skills, but he was also so encouraging, so inspiring in helping fuel that passion early on. Young sportscasters always try to emulate the big time guys. And for me, back in the 1990s, it was ESPN's Chris Berman. I wanted to be the next Chris Berman, and Mr. Wilson was cool with that. He let me be my own Berman here at Topeka West. So much like Berman would do on ESPN's NFL primetime when he had his nicknames like Ben Heavy Winter Coats, Coach Wilson let me have nicknames like AJ Hip Hopper, and Vernard Wright became Vernard, if loving you is wrong, I don't want to be right. The nicknames were probably sillier than they were creative, but Mr. Wilson was so encouraging. Always gave me complete creative control while still providing guidance and instruction to get better at the basics. Quite frankly, folks, his mentoring of me is proof of what can happen when an educator's enthusiasm for a student's dreams is equal to or greater than the ambition of that student. Don't get me wrong, I was plenty ambitious, as you can see, but Corey Wilson, he truly cared that much. My time in Topeka West debate and forensics was also key. Mr. Koontz helped me to be quick on my feet as a public speaker in debate, and Mrs. Ralston helped me to become a good persuasive speaker through numerous oration speeches, all of which were about sports, which again was an example of a Topeka West educator allowing the student to tailor the task to their ambition and thus propelling me forward. Mr. Schnacker was awesome too. He helped me to become a much better writer, and that really set me on a fast track once I got to KU. As Corey said, Mike Manns gave me my first play-by-play opportunity to work the TIT, the Topeka Invitational Tournament, at the age of 17. And reluctantly, Coach Mariani said goodbye to his 63 over par golfer, which was probably more of an indictment of my golf skills than your thoughts on my broadcasting budding talents there. But that was when I said goodbye to golf and really went all in, and I owe Mike Manns that debt of gratitude. Before leaving for KU, I had the privilege one day of cleaning the golf clubs of the late great Dean Smith, Roy Williams, and one Max Falkenstein. I was a bag boy at Topeka Country Club at the time. Though Max probably doesn't remember it, his practical career tips, instead of a monetary one, meant so much to me that day. It was the best compensation I could have received. For the record, Coach Smith tipped me $2 and Roy gave me a 5-spot, but Max's tip was the best. His encouragement on that day really made me think I could do this. Then I got to KU, and I was blessed to have the best play-by-play coach any aspiring sportscaster could ever have, the man who literally wrote the book on sportscasting, Tom Hedrick, who's with us here tonight. I learned so much from Tom. This is a man who's called Super Bowls, Cotton Bowls, the World Series as well. In a couple of months, I'm blessed with a chance to call my first national broadcast of a college football bowl game, and I owe that success to Tom and the coaching that continues to this day to make me the best I can be. Post-graduation, I was lucky enough to have the chance to work with David Lawrence, best color analyst for college football in the entire country. He quickly became one of my very best friends. In addition to David, Bud Stallworth, Wayne Simeon, Aaron Miles, Todd Reising, Scott Pollard, these were all co-hosts of mine. A KU fan's dream to hang out with people like this, and I got to do it on a daily basis. We had fun together, and I learned things from all of these people, none of which that I learned from Scott Pollard can I share with you here tonight, but it was plenty educational. If you haven't noticed by now, there's been a consistent theme throughout my story. The good Lord has surrounded me with special people at every step of my development, starting with amazing parents, incredible mentors, broadcast partners, and friends. I'm so grateful for all of these people because it's been their influence, their guidance, and encouragement that set me on a path of great fulfillment. And once again, it all began right here at Topeka West. I'll leave you tonight with a Bob Davis tradition. Remember earlier I said us aspiring broadcasters, we like to emulate the all-time greats, of which Bob Davis is certainly one. And what a great honor, by the way, it is for me to join Bob Davis in this Hall of Fame. And how about Topeka West? We've got 20% of the Big 12 voices. Take that, Trojan fans. I saw Bob do something in 2002 that I stole out of his playbook and I've used ever since. He would write a poem at the end of whatever season it was about whatever sport, KU football, KU basketball, what have you. And I've done this ever since with all the teams that I broadcast for. A poem that sums up the theme of the season, the triumphs and all of that. And so with that in mind, to honor Bob and to honor all of you that I'm so thrilled to go into the hall with here tonight, here's a little ditty about the class of 2015. What an amazing honor, the Topeka West Hall, chock full of stories of athletic glory and legends, one and all. Let's touch on each quickly, and I'll finish with a flurry. Let's first set sail with the tale of the late Coach Murray. Two state titles in a 20-year run, but then through coaching, never loafing, Murray was far from done. He kept pursuing ministry and continued helping others, a legacy clear to see amongst his Christian brothers. Then there's C.C. Metzler. Man, he could hit it far. From tee to green, the best you've seen, and always under par. And Rebecca Smith Branaman. Now that girl could really fly. No matter the meters, no one could beat her. She'd always run right by. When it came to tennis, no one could take down Kurt Reed. Quick to the net, the safest of bets, that charger would always succeed. And how about Jay Tunnel, Mr. Basketball in our state? His game so pretty, two times All-City, one of the all-time greats. I bet you remember Ryan Kelly, the Bo Jackson of a decade ago. Whether avoiding sacks or hitting jacks, he always put on a show. Finally, cross country, the 77 state title team. Excellent pacing throughout their racing fulfilled their ultimate dream. An immensely talented group, of which I'm honored to be one. Another edition of a great tradition that's truly second to none. God bless you guys. Thank you so much for having me here tonight.
Brian, you may not remember, your mother does, because I talked to her this afternoon, but when you were getting ready to enter high school, I came by with my sweaty body, wearing shorts and sneakers, to your house to try to get you to go out for cross country. It's probably a good thing you didn't. It might have hampered your golf game. What are you doing tomorrow? 1:35? We should get together, have a match play. You'd be the favorite. Our next inductee is Coach Harold Murray. Oh, by the way, before I get to that, how many in here are currently members of the Topeka West Sports Hall of Fame? Would you please stand? We appreciate your continued support of this program. It's wonderful. Our next inductee is Coach Harold Murray. Here to introduce him is a man who shared a lot of pine time with him, his head girls basketball coach, Mike Goring.
Oh, I really appreciate having to follow that. Just give me a minute, I got to think up a poem. I've always been kind of the shy type anyway, and then getting up here and speaking in front of people about the great Topeka West High School and all the honorees, and then I have to follow a legend to be Brian Haney. I sat back here and got goosebumps just listening to him. I had the distinct honor of talking about a very special friend, Harold Murray. I want you to look in the program on the page of all his accomplishments, because trying to pare down the words, I could have spoken for hours about all the years. When you get in the coaching profession, you want to surround yourself with individuals who share the same goals as you do and have a passion to make sure these goals are achieved. You want to have individuals who are loyal, devoted, committed, most importantly, care for the well-being of the young people that we work with, try to help them become more successful and do it with a passion. Mr. Harold Murray had all these traits. Mr. Murray was devoted to his family, very proud of his wife, children, Mark, Mia, Matthew. Mia and Matthew are in attendance tonight. Mark's currently hospitalized with a full hip replacement, so he couldn't be with us tonight. And I was talking with his daughter Mia a little bit ago, and Matthew, he's following right along his dad's footsteps. Because Coach Murray had hip replacements and knee replacements, and he coached with a cane, which sometimes I thought was kind of dangerous, but he wouldn't give up. He's a special grandfather as well. He treated the student athletes like his own. Mr. Murray was a devoted minister, as well as an educator and a coach. Very dedicated and loyal and devoted to our Lady Charger basketball family for over 20 years. We sat on that bench together. He was committed to making sure the young people he worked with always felt like they were somebody. And you notice in the program that's noted at the bottom of the page. That was his goal. Every young person was somebody. Wanting them to always know how important they were to be a part of our Lady Charger basketball family and to carry that into their futures. Coach Murray knew the game of basketball as well as he knew the game of life, and he knew how to teach it to all that had the honor of working with him and playing for him. He was a major contributor to all the success that the Lady Charger basketball family had. I was thinking about a couple days ago some lighthearted moments. Man, we had a plethora. How's that, Brian? Is that a pretty good word? See, I'm trying my best. But I listed two or three lighthearted moments Murray and I had, stood out. One time, Junction City High School. Second half started. We couldn't find one of our starters. I said, Murray, where is Yvonne? He said, Coach, I think you locked her in the locker room. I said, what? He said, yeah. Accidentally, when you pulled that door shut, I think she wasn't out yet, and she's still in the locker room. And it was kind of ironic because she didn't have a really good first half. And Murray said, Coach, maybe we should just leave her in there. But we didn't. We went back up the steps. She was banging, kicking, and trying to pull the door down. I sent the managers up, and I said, now make sure you tell them that we didn't mean to do that. And she got back down the bench, and she was laughing. Murray and I was even laughing. It was tie ball game at that time, and just lighthearted moments like that. And Murray said, I told Coach he should have checked before we come out. And I said, well, Yvonne, I told Murray he should have told me to remind me to check and make sure all the players were here. Shared a little smile there. Time was in Manhattan. We're not playing very well. We never did in Manhattan for some reason. I asked him, I said, Murray, you're a minister, come on. Is there anything you can do? He said, Coach, the way we're playing, there's nothing he can do either. That kind of broke the tension on the bench. Kids started playing well, so maybe he did have something to do with that. Sometimes in practices, when things wouldn't go so good, I had a tendency to blow the whistle if I didn't jerk it off my neck, acting goofy, and throw basketballs to the opposite end of the court. Murray always whistled, oh no, everybody duck. And they did. The players would duck, and they'd come up with a smile, and all the tension was gone. He was a special man. And he was special to anybody that had the honor of working with him. He'll always be remembered as a positive and caring role model for everyone that he counseled and he coached. It is my honor to present for induction into the Topeka West Sports Hall of Fame, Mr. Coach Harold Murray, Jr.
Prepared. I just wanted to say thank you on behalf of the Murrays. Dad's legacy, I remember growing up being 4 or 5 years old in the gym. These are my first memories, just, you know, stretching, getting ready for everyone to practice. And I remember watching Nadira play, and my dad, he put so much of his life into coaching. I mean, you know, because I'd get out of school, Dad wouldn't be there. He'd be either here or working with the kids somewhere, so... It's an honor to be able to stand here on my dad's behalf. I wish he were alive to be here, but he's here in spirit, so I'm sure he's smiling.
Good evening. As Coach Goring let everyone know that we do have another sibling. His name is Mark, and I was supposed to say that he is recovering from surgery, but Coach Goring decided to tell you the whole story, which is okay, but he did want me to say thank you for inducting my father into the Hall of Fame. My father and Coach Goring made a great team. Go Topeka West Chargers. I find it an honor and a privilege to accept this award on behalf of our father. He touched many lives throughout the city, and although he passed away back in 2014 and our mother passed just here May of 2015, we know that he will forever be in our hearts and he will never be forgotten. So we appreciate the award. We thank you, and God bless all of you.
Mike and Harold celebrated a lot of wins together. Mike, I'll get you off the hook. You didn't come up with a poem, so I've got one. Roses are red, violets are blue. Murray's a class act, Goring is too. Longfellow, I'm not. Our next inductee is Rebecca Smith Brandeman. She will be introduced by Leslie Meidinger Curley, a running teammate of Rebecca's. Leslie is an elite runner in her own right, having been a national JUCO champion in the 5,000 and 10,000 meter run. She is currently one of the area's finest triathletes. I'd also like to mention that Laura Cook, a friend on that same team, is here all the way from Virginia for this occasion. So, Leslie, it's up to you to introduce her.
Okay, I just want to start off with, hey, Coach, you should have threatened to have me come up here and speak in front of all these people. I probably would have run faster. But anyway, wow, this is cool. But man, those lights are bright, which I guess is a good thing. But I just want to let you know that this is such an honor and such a privilege to get to reconnect with my friend Rebecca. And as we were talking on the phone, it's been over 18 years since we've connected, and having this opportunity to catch up just reinforced in me and made me realize how amazing the friendship was that we developed as we covered the miles together as we were training and running while here at Topeka West. And just, you know, when I think back to high school, I'm like, oh my God, I would never want to do that again. Been there, done that, not going back. But now getting to think about, you know, the experience of running cross country and track and the friendships
that I developed at that time. It's like, okay, yeah, maybe I go back and do it again. But, okay, not really. So getting an opportunity to really think about Rebecca and who she is and what she was to me and sort of my experience of her is, yeah, not only is she incredibly talented in athletics, which is why she is here being inducted today, but as well as also in academics, in music, in business. I don't know how many of you knew that she actually ran an eBay business selling antique toys when we were in high school. I was always so impressed. I'm like, oh my gosh, who does that? Rebecca. So not only that, but then, you know, in athletics and then running and having the honor and privilege to get to run alongside someone so talented and just, but also so humble and so much fun and made it such an amazing experience. And running with her just made me run a run better because, for one thing, I didn't want to miss a moment getting to spend that time and also all the other friends that developed, friendships developed during that time. So I guess one other thing I have to say about Rebecca is, wow, not only she's smart, she's ambitious, curious, but so kind, yet so humble. And then also just wonderfully silly and fun, which is the reason I could hang with her, because that's, yeah, it's how I like to be and how I like to be. And so she made it always such a joy and so fun. And her performance there, getting to run on a team with Rebecca just made everyone else perform better. I remember watching her run and seeing her up there and going, oh my gosh, you know, I can't slow down. I can't do it because I have to be the best on this team I can be so that she can shine and so that the rest of us can shine as well. And I'm so grateful for that experience because it has affected me and who I am going forward and how I train and how I treat athletics. And you know, it's reflected in other friendships and things that I have through my life. And just really thinking back to Topeka West, Coach Trog, Big E. Just amazing experience, and I'm so blessed. And to get to introduce Rebecca, to have her receive this award, is I am just so humbled and honored. And I don't know how many of you know, but if there was actually soccer during the time of when we were here, yeah, she'd be being inducted for that too. So she has a wide range of abilities, but glad they didn't have soccer because, yeah, I couldn't have hung with that. And it was fun to get to hang with her. So, again, I want to just thank everyone for coming out here and, you know, with this induction and getting to honor these people that really deserve to be honored, especially after getting to know Rebecca and to knowing my impression of her in high school and how she's carried that forward and how she's living such an amazing life and still being an amazing, you know, person, mother. And yeah, and I'm just blessed and I'm honored. So without any more of me rambling on, and let me bring up Rebecca Brandeman, or Rebecca Smith Brandeman.
This is just such an emotional rush for me to have probably the biggest grouping of people that I care so much for to be in one place for me. I probably haven't had that since my wedding, so I think that being up here with lights on me at a podium is probably my version of a nightmare. There's just some people that is giving me the courage to be up here because I just need to thank them. My mom looked at the program and she's like, why didn't you list any of your accomplishments? Like, I guess I have the shortest entry in there. But, you know, I can't even remember what place I got for a lot of my races. Really, all I can remember is just the people that's what I remember from Topeka West. And so that's what I want to thank right now. My mom drove up here from Fort Worth, and I know my dad wanted to be here too, but he wasn't feeling well, so he wasn't able to make that drive. And my brother's here, and you know, I this is probably a good moment to tell you that I actually didn't really want to run cross country, and I'd like to say my mom and I disagreed. She's probably going to say that we had some pretty good arguments about that the summer before my freshman year. I didn't want to go out. My brother was already running cross country for about 2 years, and they really wanted me to run, and we went back and forth, and they put their foot down, and so off to cross country camp I went in August. And you know, for me, I thought, well, running, it doesn't sound very fun. Running long distance, going out and running 8 miles in August, or running in torrential rain, that doesn't sound fun. Well, Sean taught me that that is actually fun, to run in rain. But at the time, I didn't think that was very fun. And but off to camp I went, and the rest is history. So I thought, you know, what better forum than on a stage at a podium with a microphone and lights to tell you, Mother, you were right. Thank you. I'm so glad that you had me do this. I'm so glad that you had me go out for cross country, because I just can't imagine my life without the people and the experiences that I've had. I feel like it's probably even more poignant to me because I have two boys that are in their first year of cross country. We're living in New Zealand for 2 years, and we just moved back in July. And so they started a brand new school, and it's a K-8 school. And so I have my son Ben, who's in 8th grade, and I have my son Noah, who's in 5th grade. And they're starting a brand new school. They don't know anybody, but I found out they have a cross country team for 5th grade and up. So I was like, oh, boys, you're going out for cross country. Well, apparently they thought it sounded kind of hard, and it's not really fun to run in the heat when it's 110. And apparently I have found out sometimes they run past rattlesnakes. But now you'll know why, boys, that those arguments carry no weight, and that I hope someday, 20 years from now, you're thanking me for having you go out for cross country. The other people I wanted to thank are my friends Laura and Leslie. They were teammates at Topeka West, and they were teammates at University of Kansas. And I don't think I'm going to say it in rhyme, or maybe some other time. I just made that up. But I admire you both so much, and you've just been a big influence on who I am. You're both, I think, just great people, and I'm just so glad that I got to know you. And I couldn't think of two people that I wanted here more when I heard that I was going to be inducted to the Hall of Fame, so thank you. And then thank you, Coach Schrog and Biggie. I don't think I really appreciated how lucky I was to have coaches like you when I was in high school, but I just... like your dedication and how you made it fun and how you made us successful. Like, I just realized that combination just doesn't come along. And I think just the way you led us by example, and you're out there running with us every day, I just realized like that's such a motivator, and it means a lot to you when you're just a developing athlete. So I'm so glad that you are my coaches. And then I'd also, most especially want to thank my husband, David, who's my biggest supporter. And I had to say that he was Topeka West class of 1988. And if there was a Topeka West band Hall of Fame, he would have been inducted, I think, in the first class. He was the number one drummer in Kansas for 3 straight years. So I'm so proud of you. And maybe someday we'll be here inducting you. I can't say that with a straight face, but go band. But thank you for being here to celebrate my successes with me too. And thank you all for giving me a night like this. It's just been really special to me. Thank you.
Allow me to beat the drum a little bit about these two, Leslie and Rebecca. In the 3 years they were together, Leslie was a year older, In the 3 years, so they were together 3 years out of the four-year high school. In the 3 years they were together, they were our number one and two runners every year. And in 1986, they won the city in the league and led our girls' team to second in the state. I imagine, Rebecca, about the fifth meet of the season, when you broke your foot at Junction City, your mom might have had second thoughts. Junction City put hay bales on their cross-country course, and in jumping over a hay bale, Rebecca came down wrong, and that was the end of her season, so that was unfortunate that that was the case. Our next inductee is Ryan Kelly. He will be introduced by Warren Seitz, who is a 1999 inductee in our Hall of Fame and a former football and baseball coach here at Topeka West.
Great to be back again. I always say that it's always good to reconnect and see people that I know for many years. And I'm also glad that at my age, you know, sometimes the biggest worry is if you put it in 12 font or 14 font, so when you get up here you can still see it. But the lights are bright enough and I can see it. I've known Ryan Kelly for a number of years. He lived on Village Drive, and I moved my family over there. We built a house, and so we were neighbors throughout his time in middle school and high school. I've seen him play hundreds of times on the in his front yard, playing catch with his dad, playing catch with his friends, whether it be baseball, football. And from the beginning, really knew that he had a special talent and a special character, you know. And so really enjoyed when he had an opportunity to come and play for me at Topeka West. Obviously, he was a great player. He played from the fall of 2002 in football to the spring of 2006 in baseball. That first year, he was a freshman. We went to the state championship in football. And we had a little incident with one of our players at free safety. And we didn't know quite what to do, but we decided to put Ryan in there as a freshman and started for us all year, played in the state championship and had two interceptions in the state championship game. An amazing accomplishment playing 5A football and as a freshman. In the spring of 2003, he played on the state championship baseball team also. Had many individual accomplishments. After that, he was a four-year letterman in football and baseball, was first-team All-City as a junior and a senior, and also first-team All-League. He was All-Class 5A in football as a senior. He played in the Shrine Bowl, represented Topeka West in the Shrine Bowl after he graduated from Topeka West. Was really the first time that we... you know, now it's talked about a lot, dual threat quarterback, somebody that can run or pass. And it was really the first time that I'd had somebody that could do both. Daniel Heflin, the quarterback maybe before Ryan, probably thought he could, but he couldn't. He was a lot better at handing off to A.J. Patterson. So, Brian, you can tell him that I said that when you get back to Texas Tech. But he was the first true dual threat quarterback that we had, so we put him in the shotgun, and he passed, and he ran. He went on to Benedictine College after that, was a four-year starter, received all Heart of America Conference recognition each of his 4 years. He graduated. When he graduated, he holds the career total offense and the career passing records there still. Had several single season or single game records when he was there. He is currently an assistant at Benedictine College in football. We still talk a lot. Last year we met and we talked for 3 hours, I think, just about X's and O's. I love that. He loves that. He was the heart and soul of our team at that point in time and is still a great friend to me. So I'm proud and honored to introduce Mr. Ryan Kelly to the Topeka West Hall of Fame.
Before I start thanking people, I want to apologize to Mr. Mariani for screening your call back in May when you told me I was going to be coming in tonight. So I'm really glad I called you back. But it's always good to be home, and I'm honored to be here tonight as a member of the 2015 Hall of Fame inductee class, and I have the induction committee to thank for that. I know that's a difficult job. To select who's going to go in. I was on that committee firsthand, so I appreciate the fact that they thought I was worthy of this selection. I want to thank Coach Seitz for being such a good mentor to me and a good friend to me. I always look forward to the times that I always look forward to the times we get to reunite and catch up, and I appreciate you being here tonight. I want to thank all the other coaches and teachers that had an impact on me in my high school career and have left a long-lasting impression on me and helped me strive to be the person and coach that I want to be in the future. Guys like Chris Perry, Coach Cowden, may he rest in peace, Coach Seitz, Coach Eshbaugh, Jeff Dixon, teachers like Mr. Mariani, Corey Wilson, just to name a few. You guys really made this an enjoyable place to be and a wonderful atmosphere and environment, so for that I thank you all. I want to thank my teammates, guys like Jay Tunnel that I get to go into the Hall of Fame with tonight. A lot of my teammates I got to play with in high school, I played with since I was 5 or 6 years old, and any individual accomplishment that you have over the course of a season or a career really always takes a back seat to the experiences that you have with your teammates, and I always had some good ones. Didn't always play on the most talented teams, but played on some good ones, played on some bad ones. But I always had good teammates, so thank you all for that. I want to thank my family. I couldn't ask for better parents. Mom, I'm pretty sure to this day you don't know what a first down is or how many innings there are in a baseball game or a football game. But nonetheless, I appreciate all your love and support over the years. And for that, I love you and I thank you. Dad's my biggest fan, and anybody that knows my dad knows that he's my biggest fan, and he'd tell you that. But, from he introduced me to the competitor in me at a very early age, and you instilled in me to always strive to be the best I could be. And for that, I love you and I thank you. My big sister, Alyssa. Class of 2004, her friends were my teammates early on in high school, so that didn't always jive very well, and there were plenty of times where she could have been embarrassed of her annoying little brother, but instead, for the most part, she chose to look after me and be proud of me, and for that, I love you and I thank you. And I want to thank my beautiful fiance Agnes for making the trip down here tonight with me and sharing this night, and she often reminds me that it's the little things in life, it's the little moments in life that mean the most and that you need to capture, and I'm quite guilty of not following through with that, especially being a college football coach this time of year. Things are a little chaotic, but I want to thank her for constantly reminding me of that, because tonight I get to kind of slow down and really reflect on some good times with some good people, and there's a lot of good people in this room, and I hope everybody gets to do that tonight. Congratulations to all the inductees, and hope you get to reflect on your good times with the good people and the positive people in your life. So thank you very much, and go Royals.
The The Sports Hall of Fame was designed for athletes like Ryan. I believe true athletes who try to compete in as many sports as they can, and Ryan did just that, competing in football, basketball, and baseball, and all at a very high level. Our next inductee is C.C. Metzler. He will be introduced by Jack Wiley, a 2011 inductee into our Hall of Fame, and a golf coach who taught everything he knew to C.C. and how to play golf.
Well, I do thank Coach Schrog for letting the cat out of the bag, because that is true. When I started coaching CC, I didn't know a thing, and I still don't know a thing other than I enjoyed watching him play. And it is truly an honor for me tonight to introduce CC, and I just want to talk a little bit about some of the things. A lot of these people have been talking tonight are fairly recent. I think it was 37 years ago or somewhere in that vicinity that I was able to work with CC and the rest of the group that were golfers. And the program was different then. In other words, we had a rule or whatever for the state that we had two-man and four-man teams. Now I believe that the format for golf is where they would have six players and you count your best four. Where back when CC was playing, we pretty much had to count every one, because each one was an individual that counted towards the scoring of the team. During CC's senior year, he was pretty much a solid four-man member of the team. Once in a while, he would play two-man, but most of the time it was four-man. And again, we had very, very good golfers back there, as CC will probably tell you. And just wanted to mention some of them that I remember being on his team. There was Van Reichert, who played a lot of golf afterwards, Scott Kreider, Scott Hood, Ken Kurtzel, and Jay Nelson. And they were the team that went ahead to win the regional and go on to the state in Salina. And at that time, the state was a two-day tournament. It was 36 holes instead of 18. And so it was a different kind of a game in a lot of ways. But anyway, the meet that sticks out in my mind about as good as any was the Salina Invitational. And CC went into that Invitational at Salina. He was the number one golfer. He shot a 67, which if you add those two together, then you're close to the 135 that they were talking about earlier. But anyway, he shot a 67, finished first in a group of about 125 golfers that day. And just really, you know, that kind of set the tone for the rest of the year for the kids, and they all played well. And like I said, they won the city, won the regional, and I would imagine got about fourth in the state. I can't really remember. It's been a couple days. But after graduating from high school, CC went on to college. He went into the Kansas City, Kansas Community College. He played there 2 years and was very successful. And if you read the program, you can figure out exactly where he kind of ended up and a lot of that. But he went from Kansas City, he went into Washburn University, where again, he played on the national level at the NAIA, I believe it was then. And so after that, he went ahead and he played in numerous city, state, amateur, and professional tournaments, and was very, very successful. After a certain length of time playing those, he had to make a kind of a decision about his career, what he was going to do, and he decided to go into the corporate world. He went in and he worked at AT&T until he retired in 2008. Now, he's been retired for a couple years, and he has a little bit of time. So he enjoys golf, as you would think. He also enjoys some hunting. He enjoys breaking horses and working with animals. He actually performs or competes at the I guess it's kind of a cowboy riding situation. I can't really think of the name right now. But anyway, he competes on the national and world level there and is very successful. And so at this time, it is my honor to introduce you to CeCe Metzler in the 2015 Hall of Fame.
Thanks, Jack, for being here this evening and that wonderful introduction. Jack was not only my teacher here at Topeka West and my golf coach, but over the years has become a good friend. It's been great these past weeks to reconnect with Jack and spend some time reminiscing about our times together during my high school years. I'd also like to thank Topeka West and the Hall of Fame Committee for considering my nomination and selection for this unbelievable honor. Thanks to my family and friends that are here with me tonight. Without your love and support, none of this would have been possible. Golf has been a major part of my life ever since I can remember. However, over the past several years, as Jack kind of mentioned, I've traded in my golf spikes for a pair of cowboy boots and spurs. I've directed my competitive spirit to riding and showing horses. Even though I don't play much these days, I'm sure I'll return to the game as time goes on, since missing a tee shot doesn't hurt near as much as falling off a horse. But golf has been that consistent thread in my life and all things that have seemed to branch out of it. I've had the opportunity to play at various levels all over the country, and through the game of golf, I've had the pleasure to meet and play with some great folks. When I first started preparing my remarks for tonight and this evening, it seemed appropriate to talk about how I got here, to talk about some of my successes on the course over the years, be it tournaments that I won, or some of the better rounds that I was able to put together. Don't get me wrong, all that was awesome. Jack mentioned a few of them, and I appreciate that. However, when I really started to think about my most special times on the course and the things that I enjoyed most, it always came back to who I was with, not necessarily how well I did or didn't play. Be it my four-man team here at Topeka West, my college teammates at Kansas City, Kansas Community College, or Washburn University, it was the lifelong friendships that started on the course that have meant the most. Over the years growing up, I played most of my golf with my dad. He introduced me to the game at a young age and spent countless hours with me on the course. I never really had much formal golf instruction. Most of it came from my dad, who was a pretty accomplished player himself. He is now 84, and we still get to play together from time to time and even tee it up in a tournament or two. So be it the times that I've spent with friends, teammates, or family on the course, these moments are the ones that I do cherish the most. That's one of the many great things about the great game of golf. It brings people together, be it accomplished players, high or low handicappers, young or old. All of us can enjoy the game based on your own ability and sharing each other's success as we spend a lifetime trying to perfect a game that can never be perfected. When I look back now, I realize how significant a role golf has played in my life. At a young age, it taught me how to be a humble winner and deal with defeat. It gave me a positive activity through my teen years, not keeping me out of all trouble, unfortunately, but giving me something to focus on and try and excel at. It helped pay for my college education through scholarships, and as I began my business career, golf opened many doors that may have never been possible without it. There is no doubt that golf helped fuel my 20-year career with AT&T. So I'm grateful for the great game of golf and what it has allowed me to do and taught me over the years. Golf has taught me respect, honesty, and dignity, all qualities we can aspire to have in life. I can truly say the game of golf has helped shape me into the person that I am today. Golf has provided me many things, including this tremendous recognition I have received tonight. It's been a great ride, one that I wouldn't change for anything. And lastly, I'd like to close tonight by congratulating all the other inductees on their success in athletics and I'm sure their accomplishments in life. Thank you.
My hamstrings getting a little weak going up and down the steps, but I'll tough it out. CC, you may not remember that I tried to get you to go out for cross country. I gave you my big spiel about how it would get you in shape for wrestling, but I guess I wasn't very convincing because you just kind of chuckled and walked off. Too bad, too, because you could have gone into the Hall of Fame as a member of the 1977 cross country team had you done that. Our next inductee is Kurt Reed. He will be introduced by our beloved Corey Wilson, who certainly needs no introduction.
Thanks, Joe. I have the honor of getting to present one of my oldest friends on the planet, Kurt Reed. I've known Kurt since I was a young teenager, playing tennis in one of the best environments anyone could ever have, Hughes Tennis Courts on 8th Street over by Gage Park. It was our sandlot, a place where we all did so many things together, and unfortunately, it was one of those special places and moments in time that we didn't realize was so special until after it had passed. The story of that place alone could fill up an entire evening for many of us who grew up there. Kurt comes from incredible bloodlines. His father was Larry Reed, a beloved educator, coach, and principal. Larry was also a tennis enthusiast and was a mentor to a lot of us kids at Hughes Courts. And that's where my story with Kurt begins. Larry also ran the local tennis pro shop out of his basement, and so we were all regulars at his house and, of course, became extended children to he and his wife, Peggy. For me, it was like having another set of parents, and I really needed them in my teenage years. Larry pulled us tennis kids aside one day and told us about his 10 or 11-year-old son, Kurt. He wanted to know if we'd take him under our 14-year-old wings and help him along with the game. We, of course, would have done anything for Mr. Reed, so of course we accepted. It wasn't long before he was no longer under our wings. I'm not sure he ever was. Kurt was a natural fit for our group of guys. Kurt would turn out to be one of the best junior players in Topeka history. Kurt was a member of an elite group of kids in his grade. Three of them went to Topeka High, but Kurt's dad and mom were determined to honor boundaries, and so Kurt went to Topeka West. Had Kurt gone to Topeka High, I have little doubt that he would have been a two-time state doubles champion at the very least. Instead, Kurt carved out an incredible career here, playing number one all 3 years of his high school career. Your program indicates that as his career as a Charger, he was a fourth place finisher in doubles as a sophomore. As a junior, he was fourth in the state in singles, and as a senior, he was the state runner-up. No one worked harder than Kurt did. If he wasn't playing, he was training. I found out firsthand on more than one occasion that to go on a training run with Kurt was folly. I'm sure those days of training with me were a waste to him, but that's the kind of guy my friend Kurt is, a true friend and brother in every way. All that work paid off for Kurt as he would go on to college tennis and shine at Tulsa University, Washburn University, and Kansas State. As an adult player, Kurt just continued to flourish, holding several sectional rankings and becoming a bit of a phenom in that he kept playing and winning tournaments and open divisions even as he got older, frankly, too old to be doing the kind of winning that he was doing. He's just that good. I'm so proud of Kurt's playing career, but I'm even more proud of another quality that Kurt has. Kurt has never turned down a kid who's asked for help on his game. Kurt gave back as much to the game of tennis and to the Topeka tennis community as he ever received. That's a quality that goes a long, long way with folks like me. It was done quietly with no fanfare, just Kurt being Kurt. I could talk about Kurt Reed all night. I really could. I could tell you stories about things that we did off the court together, a bunch of guys who I cherish often when I think about that little patch of ground on 8th. But Kurt gets to talk next, so I'm not going to go there. In closing, I've thought about this last statement a lot. I really have. I've thought about how it might affect some folks in the Topeka tennis community, but then I realized that they too know that Kurt Reed will no doubt soon be a member of the Topeka Tennis Hall of Fame. So I'm glad that we got to him first. I believe that Kurt Reed is the best tennis player to ever play at Topeka West High School, and I believe him to be one of the top five or so players in Topeka tennis history, period. I'm glad that Topeka West got Kurt in our Hall of Fame first. I'm proud to present my friend, Kurt Reed, as a member of the Topeka West Sports Hall of Fame.
Wow, I've got to follow up on that. You know, when I was talking to my wife, I said, she said, well, so what are you thinking? And I said, I'm in the wrong place. They got the wrong guy. But thank you, Corey. Maybe not. I don't know. I was standing between, Cece and I were standing next to Jay and Ryan today, and I couldn't help but think back when I went to Tulsa University, and I was there on my very first day. I was standing between a guy about Jay's size and a guy about Ryan's size, and they looked down at me and they said, are you a tennis player or a golfer? So I thought CC would really appreciate that. But congratulations to all the past inductees. I know there's a lot of them out there, a lot of them who go by the term coach. I think the older you get, the more you realize calling somebody coach is a tremendous honor. So I talked to my wife, and I was kind of asking her, what are you going to say? What are you thinking? And I said, I'm really nervous about this. I said, I've been in China the past 8 years. The way I should start this thing is, Wang Shanhao, and then usually about three or four people would understand that I just said good evening. Even the Chinese, okay? So I can't understand, Chinese is an amazing language, not one that I speak. I speak it, no one understands it. I said, Rose, I'm going to be in front of these people. And, I've got to figure out, this is the first time that I've spoke in front of a group that understands what I say. She said, don't worry, they won't understand you tonight either. I said, okay, dear. That takes some pressure off. But I'm trying to figure out how to focus this thing. And I wrote a speech, and I rewrote a speech. And then I realized, okay, now I've been playing tennis for over 40 years. So to try and condense it down, if anybody wants to sit down and drink a beer, we can talk for days about playing tennis, but I tried to keep it a little bit more to Topeka West. Topeka West had a great legacy of tennis players before me. John Waltz, who's in this Hall of Fame, Bruce Clark, who I saw here tonight, a guy named Greg Bowler. These guys all played Division I tennis, and they were my idols and mentors. At Topeka High School, we had a guy named Hedberg, who happens to be a coach, Hall of Fame coach over at Washburn Rural. Mark Nordstrom, Mick Lynch, these guys were all mentors to me. And as Corey said, I had a lot of people who kind of took me under their wing. And like Cece, I didn't have a lot of lessons. We just played and I listened. And I can't tell you what an impact that had growing up. And these guys are still my best friends in the whole world. And it means a lot. And you're so lucky to have great coaches like Coach Schrog and Coach Wilson and now Coach Davids, and it means so much. One of the biggest compliments that I had was a kid who was a state champion, as Corey said. To my credit or to my pain, in fact, when it got around state time, my phone would start ringing off the hook. And it'd be kids going to play a state championship, and one of the players they're going to play is left-handed, and oh my God, I need a left-hander to practice with, and can you play with me tonight? And sometimes it was I'd be playing three times in an evening, and when you're getting a little bit older, sometimes the next day is not as pleasant as the evening. I mean, it's great in the evening, and you feel really good, but sometimes it took a crane to get me out of bed the next day. So, but one of those state champions I saw at a Washburn alumni match, and he said to me, he says, Kurt, I'm trying to work with some kids because I want to do for them what you did for me. And that was probably the greatest compliment I've ever had. That's me paying back these guys that took care of me and paying it forward a little bit, and some other kids doing it. And I think with that attitude, I mean, we can probably keep this thing going. And Topeka, even though it's a small town, can have an extremely successful tennis program. So anyway, thank you so much. I appreciate your time and getting a chance to listen. You know, I don't get this many people listen to me anymore, so it's kind of nice. So thank you so much, and I appreciate the opportunity to be here. I appreciate the induction, and definitely appreciate Corey's kind words. So thank you.
Kurt, as you know, I worked in an office next door to your dad's for several years, and I see a lot of him in you, and you should consider that a compliment. Our next inductee is Jay Tunnel. He will be introduced by his high school coach, Chad Eshbaugh, who took his team to the state championship finals.
Thanks a lot, Jay, for inviting me, first of all. It's the first week of the season, so I'm kind of fighting through it here a little bit. It truly is an honor just to be back. Topeka West is a great place. It's not a good place. It's a great place. I was here for 5 years, and I look back on it now, and I'm not so sure it wasn't my favorite 5 years of my coaching career. At this point in time, the people I met, the coaches I was mentored by, the student body, the atmosphere. When I say that Topeka West holds a special place in my heart, it's where I think my family grew, and I learned what it is to coach basketball. And one of the things that made it so great was having players like Jay. He was a great player. I mean, he wouldn't be here tonight if he wasn't a great player. He was a Gatorade State Player of the Year. He was first team All-State, first team All-City multiple times, first team All-League. I don't even want to count the number of honors he received in high school. And all that's really important. I really thought a lot about it because I didn't want to think about the practice we had today. So I wanted to think about this all the way driving here tonight. But what do I remember most, and what really sticks with me about Jay Tunnel and why he's going to be a great inductee into your Hall of Fame? And it's the kind of person he is. You know, it's so easy in today's society, and I've been blessed to coach a lot of good players. Guys like Jay don't come along all the time. Guys that are great players and great people from great families who don't care if they get any credit. And they're always quick to accept all the blame. Those guys you just don't find. People who know Jay know he would never make a big deal about himself, ever. You know, he called me on the phone and said, "Hey, Coach, I got this little thing. Would you come up?" And I didn't know if you had time or not. And that's Jay. I was here for 5 years. 3 of the 5 years, we finished top three in the state. We won multiple league titles, TIT, sub-state championships. And through it all, what a great group of guys. You know, Kasam Moss is in the back of the room right there. Selfless. Didn't care if he had 20 or he had 2 as long as we won. And did it with a smile on his face. Came to practice, to work, every day, with the idea of, you know, I hate running. I really don't want to do all this, but you never would have guessed it. By the way, he led our guys. And it was a group process that allowed that to happen. When he signed his scholarship to Indiana State University after spending his time here at Topeka West, I was so proud, and I was jealous. I was jealous of Coach Waltman and Coach Bender and some of the guys we talked about before we got, because they got to coach him now. And I knew there weren't going to be a ton of guys coming along that I was going to coach who I enjoyed coaching as much as I did Jay Tunnell. At Indiana State, he was on the All-Valley freshman team. He was a scholar athlete, honorable mention. He was All-Missouri Valley honorable mention. He was on the All-Missouri Valley most improved team. He scored over 1,000 points, 1,168 to be exact, and had over 600 rebounds. I watched him play on television. I watched him play live. Every time I got a chance to see him play, I just shook my head and thank God I had the chance to coach him. Topeka West High School is a great, great place. And you have a lot of things going on here on a daily basis that once you're gone, you take for granted. Or don't take for granted. But once you've separated yourself a little bit and look back, I think what you see is a Hall of Fame. And the individuals that come through here are truly some of the best, not just in the city of Topeka, but in the state of Kansas and the Midwest in general. Jay Tunnell was a great basketball player. He was a great teammate. He was a great leader, and I was blessed to have the opportunity to coach him. I wish him nothing but the best in his future. I'm sure he's going to be great. So thank you very much for having me, Jay. Congratulations on your induction into the Hall of Fame.
Appreciate that, Coach. When they told me, when I got the call from Mariani, it told me I was going in, I started thinking about, you know, stories and things that I could tell. And I think the first one that popped into my head was the first time I ever met Coach. It was a summer camp for our freshman year, and I think I had to miss the first 2 days because I was in some baseball tournament. So, good start. New coach, first year, missing the first 2 days of your first camp. So I get there and shake his hand, and I think Micah's youngest daughter was maybe 4 months old, and she's 15, 16 now, and we start getting into drills, and he goes, you know, you're a pretty good-looking kid. You might be able to dunk by the time you're a sophomore. Looking pretty good. So I was like, hey, I think I'm going to like this guy. He's really positive. Well, we get into a few more drills, and we start going up and down, and I realize, you know, I'm pretty much the only big guy. I've gone a couple times, and I'm like, hey, somebody jump in there real quick. Let me get one. Well, everything stopped rather quickly. And in so many words, a lot of them four, I was told that I'm not allowed to come out until I'm told to come out. And that was just kind of an eye-opening experience. I always felt like I played hard, I enjoyed the game, but when I got to Topeka West, it was the first time I ever knew how to work hard. Our practices, our workouts, I mean, it got to the point to where we created an atmosphere to where we had just as many guys out for summer basketball as we did for fall football. We had a blast. Another story that comes to mind, and you know, he always tells me, he said, I hate to run. We're coming off a Highland Park game, double overtime. We're sitting at practice the next day, and we get done with everything after we're done running sprints, and he comes up to me and he says, hey, I'm sorry. What are you sorry for? Didn't get you out last night. I was like, it just kind of hit me, you know, where I had come from a freshman to where I could barely get up and down the floor five or six times to where I was playing 40 minutes. A lot of that is to coach. I know that my brother sitting back there would attribute a lot to his fitness, to him waking him up before the rest of us would lift. Him and coach would go run. So I appreciate everything that he's done. I appreciate him coming down here tonight. They got a big season coming up, and I hope that they do well. Best part about Topeka West was that I got to play sports with all my friends. I think nowadays with people getting to go where they want to, you don't get to see that a whole lot. Some of my best friends are here, three of them to be exact. One of them I'm going in with tonight. I have the opportunity, and I'm blessed to be in all three of their weddings. And that's just the kind of relationships we built while we were here. I've known these guys since I was 5, 6 years old. We came up together. We went through the whole deal together. We won, we lost.
We had some good teams, like Ryan said. We had some bad teams, but we always had a good time. I'd like to thank some of the other coaches, whether it be Dave Harper, who coached me probably since I was 5 years old in every sport that we ever did with my dad until we were 13, to Bruce Mellon, who was our French middle school coach, to obviously Coach Eschball when I was here, and the various college coaches that I had the privilege of playing for. A lot of my teammates, like I said, I still am friends with a lot of them. I'm looking forward. Our 10-year high school anniversary is this weekend. Get to see a lot more of them. And you just realize how fast time is going. So I'd like to thank a lot of my teammates. Last but not least, I'd like to thank my parents, grandparents, aunt and uncle. At my senior speech at Indiana State, I thanked everybody but my parents. So I'm going to go ahead and make sure that I get them in. Anybody that knows my mom and dad, I think you know that I the apple didn't fall far from the tree. Their outlook on things has always been positive. Everything about how I was brought up was all about just trying to do the best you can and being the best you can. I get a lot of strength from my mom, you know, with what she has to deal with on a daily basis. And I almost feel like my dad should be going in here with me. He even broke out the old Topeka West outfit from a lot of the games. Corey Wilson helped make him a semi-celebrity with a lot of those basketball games they put on TV. I think anytime there was a questionable call made on Topeka West, my dad got a full screenshot. So, we had some good times, but I would like to thank my parents. I don't know any other parents that went to as much stuff as they did, whether it be at Topeka West, taking off work, or even when I moved to Indiana. I don't know how many nights my dad would call me on a Friday, getting off at 2:30, said he'd knock on my door at midnight, wake up, watch a noon game, and be back at work on Monday. So I can't thank them enough. I can't thank everybody else that's with us tonight enough. The Hall of Fame committee, I'd like to congratulate everybody else who's going in tonight. I do truly appreciate it, and it's an honor, and I feel like this is more of just a thank you to all those people who helped us get there. So thank you.
Jay, the title of Mr. Kansas Basketball was well deserved, and to follow that up with your collegiate success was truly noteworthy accomplishment. That takes care of our individual induction. Now it's time to induct the 1977 State Championship Boys Cross Country team. It's kind of bittersweet because it's a happy time, our people being recognized. It's a sad time in the sense that three of that number are deceased, and one is in the St. Louis hospital fighting for his life. So that part is sad. This particular jacket that I've got on that doesn't fit, since I've gotten fat, belonged to Phil Rudolph, one of those deceased. Topeka West, four-year letterman, patch, state champs, 1977, cross country. This is compliments of Mrs. Potter, who is Phil's mother-in-law. Also tonight, Jeannie Wallace is here, who is Kit Wallace's mother, and the parents of David Thurston are also here. So that's a mighty big welcome to those folks who have suffered so much. I would like to have the cross-country team, including the two coaches, please come to the stage. They come from after 38 years, they're spread out from coast to coast, from Georgia to California. So obviously they couldn't all be here, but we're thankful for the ones that could. And I'd like to make a comment about each one of them as the night goes on. While I would like to take credit for all the success that these athletes had, it would be wrong of me to do that, because I had two assistants who were the best you could ever ask for, in Gene Ironman Johnson, right here behind me, and Earl Big E Williams. And the contributions that they made were enormous. And a large portion of our success was due to their contribution. In the picture in the program, you will notice six girls. They were Karen Langworthy, Liz McCoy, Jan Sprigg, Judy Thorne, Nancy Timberlake, and Jennifer Marker. I mention them because in a sport without cheerleaders, they served that purpose by cheering and supporting this guys' team. They were our first girls cross-country team as the cross-country for girls state meet began to be established. They were the first. This 1977 team was a great disappointment at first, in capital letters at first. We were coming off a runner's high from previous years. Topeka High was undefeated in 74, second in the state in 75 and 76, and then came 1977 with three returnees and a hot shot from Washburn Rural transfer named Richard Seeley. Expectations were high, so in the first meet at Wawbego, we were fourth. We hadn't lost at Topeka High since 1972. We hadn't finished fourth in 5 years. I was disappointed. Then I got to the bus, and there were orange peelings all over the place and candy wrappers and things outside our bus. And I don't know if you guys remember it, but I raised my voice in anger one of the few times I ever did, and I felt bad about that later because a guy shouldn't have to raise his voice in anger to a cross-country team, for goodness sakes. And they were good folks. But the point is that while we didn't get immediately better, we finished fourth a couple of different times early in the year, well, a third and a fourth. We were beaten by four of the six teams in our league in the early season, but give credit to these guys, because rather than give up, they continued to work hard and encourage one another, and in the fifth meet of the season at Junction City, they won a triangular, first place, and that was the beginning of a new team. They won every other meet from then on out, including the city and league. In the city and the regional, they did take second place in league. They got beat by Salina Central, who later on the very next week, they were beat by 40 points and by 60 points in the state. Go figure. I don't know how that happens, but it did. So they certainly were no longer a disappointment, but a testament to the fact that effort and perseverance pays off. And they finished the season 53-9. Now I'd like to introduce each of these and the contributions that they made. There were 28 boys on the team, and I'll introduce them alphabetically by class. They live coast to coast, as I said, so not all could attend, but here we go. Bob Bertelson ran as a junior and senior. He is not here. Ben Crady lives in Tucson. He ran on the state team in 1977. He had an average finish for Topeka West of 6.6. Have Doug Inlow, who lives in Gladstone, Missouri, who ran all 3 years. And my greatest memory of Doug Inlow and David Thurston was at running camp. They were on a team that had a bunch of little guys. Any of the other guys on that team with Thurston and Inlow? Well, they whipped everybody in tug of war. We couldn't figure out how that could happen. Doug was a big, strong guy, and David was strong. I was fairly big, but not necessarily strong. But they used their heads. They were both too smart for their own good, and they figured out that if you plant your foot parallel to the rope, they can't pull you over the top. And all the rest of us were 90 degrees to the rope and had no strength at all, and they just pulled us into oblivion. David Hall is here. He ran Topeka all 3 years. Gentlemen here, Craig Long, David lives in Topeka, I think, yeah. Craig Long lives in Mesa, Arizona. He's not here. He ran all 3 years. Larry Rice, no, he lives in Topeka. He only ran his senior year, but he was in our top 14. And then there's Phil Rudolph, who is since deceased, a victim of cancer. He was our number one runner in 1977. With an average team finish of 1.3. He was 10th in the state meet, a race I still remember very well because he took off like it was a 100-meter dash and hit oxygen debt in the first quarter. And I thought, uh-oh, we're in big trouble. But he had to recognize the toughness that Phil had. And he gutted it out, and he finished 10th. Without him, we'd have been in trouble. He ran 9:39 to win the regional, and he also ran on the team in 1976 that was second. So he ran in the state 2 years. Tremendous asset. Rod Stackett is not here. He lives in Concordia. I think he had some health problems, heart problems, not too long ago. He had an average team finish of 5. He ran on the state team, gave tremendous leadership. Rod was not bashful about taking leadership, and I often said we might not have won the state without him because he was kind of the glue that held the team together. David Thurston, since deceased because of a weightlifting accident, was a 3-year participant, a man of few words, but a tremendous teammate. Always had words of encouragement for everybody, very well respected by all. Norm Toussaint, I could not locate. He came out as a senior. Scott Winters, I could not locate. He came out as a junior senior in our was in our top 11. So those were our seniors. Our juniors. David Borghardt lives in Topeka. His mother called me this morning and said he's sick today and can't come, and expressed her regrets about that. He also ran on the 78 team the next year that was 6th in the state. Scott Hellis did not compete as a sophomore, but he did run as a senior. Todd Croker is here. Todd lives in Topeka, didn't compete as a sophomore, but did run as a junior and senior and did very well. Carl Miller lives in Chicago. An outstanding 3-year career. He was the only one up here to run state all 3 years. As a sophomore, he was our number 5 runner. As a junior, he was our number 4 runner. As a senior, he was our number 3 runner. That's very good for a half-miler, which was his specialty. Half-milers normally don't like to run longer distances, but he did, and he did it well. His track career was even better than his cross-country career, and then he went on to have a great career at Kansas State. So that's Carl. Paul Payne lives in Wilmington, North Carolina. He was a top 10 runner in both his junior and senior seasons. He followed his father's footsteps and became a doctor. His father's here tonight as well. Blake Raleigh lives in Flagstaff, Arizona. He competed in 1977. My son lives in Flagstaff, and he found out that Blake owns a confectionery shop. He sells nuts and candy, and has been so successful at it that he's opening a store in Tucson, as well as, or in Phoenix, as well as Flagstaff. Tim Schmidt is here. Tim lives in Houston, Texas, so he's a long ways from home, and competed both as a sophomore and junior. Happy to see him here today. One that I did not recognize, and because he somehow looked different, but he's a policeman in Houston, so that's a tough job. Richard Seeley, I'm so sorry I could not find him. I did everything short of hire a private detective to find him, and I couldn't. I've since heard that he might be in Texas. I don't know. But he came over from Washburn Rural and was enormous help to us. He had an average team finish of 3.5, also ran the next year in the state when they got second. Invaluable and a great transfer. And then there's Kent Wallace, a victim of Lou Gehrig's disease. Very sad situation where he went from good health to disability in very short order. He was an outstanding runner. He ranked 5.7 as a sophomore, 1.9 as a junior, and was our top runner as a senior, 1.1. He was 7th in state in 1977, had a top 10 finish the following year as well. Did equally well in track as he did in cross country. He was both a league and regional champion, as well as having an outstanding track career. So those are our juniors. Sophomores, we had Bob Akins, who lives in Alpharetta, Georgia. He made steady improvement throughout his career. I talked to him just recently, and he said, you know, Coach, I was 21st man as a sophomore. And by the time I got out of here, I was City B champion, and he was, and ran on, had an average finish for Topeka West of 7.0 in his senior year. Kent Bailey, I could not locate. He competed as a sophomore. Brian Christensen, he's the one that's struggling in St. Louis Hospital. He had a serious heart attack. He was hoping to be here tonight, but it's not possible. He, too, ran on state meet teams in 77, or 78 and 79. He did not run on the state meet as a sophomore, but he did as a junior and senior and was our number two, three runner his senior year. A lot of these sophomores had not yet, outside of Wallace and Miller, were not varsity material as sophomores, but made enormous improvement. One of those was Paul Cochran, who lives in El Cerritos, California. He was in town last weekend, and I got to talk to him a little bit. We had lunch over at Bad Joe Cafe. He had a distinguished cross-country career. He was had an average finish for Topeka West of 5.4 as a sophomore, 4.0 as a junior, 3.0 as a senior. He ran on state teams in 78 and 79 also, and probably would have as a sophomore if he hadn't got injured. He missed the last half of the season with injury. Tony Wallman is here. He lives in Topeka. He also ran all 3 years. I don't think I ever saw Tony without a smile on his face. So he's that kind of guy is good for a team. Kevin Nicholson, I could not locate. He was in Topeka West top 10 all 3 years of his high school career and also ran in a state meet in 78 and 79. Bruce Noe lives in Mesa, Arizona. Talk about tremendous improvement. His average as a sophomore was 12.2. As a junior, it was 2.0 and 1.2 as a senior. He developed that fast. He ran on state teams in 78 and 79. He was 13th in 1979. He is a veterinarian now in Mesa, Arizona, and his place is called Noe's Ark. Nice. Marty Schmid, I could not locate. He ran all 3 years, always in our top 14. And now, I believe, Carl, are you the designated spokesman?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Carl,
Thank you very much. So we do a sport where we run with our coaches, and it makes a big difference. And we just don't run with them. I mean, we hung out with them. I can remember one other time he raised his voice at us, and it's when we got in a big mud fight on an 8 or 10 mile run, and he found the locker room after we were there, and he wasn't very happy that day either. But the respect that I can tell you, anybody who ran for these three guys and ran with them, whether it was cross country or track, there wasn't anybody who didn't love competing for these guys, and whether you were the best guy or you weren't the best guy, they made you feel like you were. Our folks all traveled around and watched us as we competed. The Thurstons who were here and Dr. Payne and my mom and my dad and a lot of other people followed us all over while we competed. And it was a real good family situation. I just want to thank you. Shrog's been a big influence in my life. Of course, Biggie and then Iron Man, that, you know, there's nothing like competing where your coach can kick your ass every single day. And that's the way it was with Iron Man. So we all knew who the best runner on the team was, and it was him. So on behalf of my teammates, I'd like to thank you and congratulate the other inductees and Coach Shrog. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Carl. A good job for somebody put on the spot. Very good. You guys can go on down now. Thank you so much. There are several common denominators among tonight's inductees, as well as those who have preceded them. Number one, they've had tremendous parental support, or if not parental, at least a mentor of some kind who has given them a sense of direction, a responsibility, encouragement, and self-esteem. Number two, the inductees tonight and previously have been academic standouts as well as athletic stars, and that's more important than most people know. And number three, the contributions of the inductees to the communities in which they live and the world in general has been enormous. Honoring them in the Hall of Fame is the least we could do in appreciation. So this concludes our 18th annual Topeka West Sports Hall of Fame induction ceremony. The word annual suggests there will be a 19th annual. Believe me, there are many deserving candidates to be honored, as the selection committee well knows. Please continue your support of Topeka West and its athletic endeavors. So long, have a nice, safe trip home, and thank you for your attendance.